Kasky. So you were a teacher on tenure track, and then you moved on to become a career coach.
Mm-hmm.
Teaching is a difficult skill by itself,
mm-hmm.
but career coaching entails looking at a student's or a professional's experiences
mm-hmm.
and adding to it their emotional challenges and also what their requirements are.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you address that? So what does career coaching for the teaching and academic community entail?
It is, as you said, because it deals with people's individual experiences and their individual emotional capacities and needs and whatnot, it is very individualized. So I don't necessarily do the exact same thing for everybody, but I do always start with sort of an assessment of where the person is right now. I use a tool that's called the fulfillment wheel. And we look at 8 areas of your life, and you can sort of rank how satisfied you are with your life in that area. And that gives the client an opportunity to sort of assess, how is my health, how are my finances, how's my physical environment, how are my studies, how's my scholarship, those sorts of things. So they spend time with their own internal compass a bit, and then we have a conversation about where are you the most dissatisfied?
Okay.
Where would you like to be? And what do you think are the hurdles in between there? And once I have a sense of, you know, point A, where you are now, point B, where you want to go, and what you perceive those hurdles to be, then I can have a conversation with you about avoiding the hurdles or getting over the hurdles.
Okay. So in this interview especially, we are focusing on the students of age group 16 to 22. Because at 16, you're thinking about what am I going to do at university, and that is a stress that is added upon on top of schoolwork and all the challenges they have to face.
Yeah.
And then when you're finished with university, you're thinking about graduation. What are the next steps? How
mm-hmm.
do I prepare myself for grad school, or how do I prepare myself for a job?
Yeah.
So how do you address these types of questions when a student has them?
Mm-hmm.
And how do you separate out what are they concerned about
mm-hmm.
and what are their abilities?
Mm. That's a good question to ask. So looking at, starting with age 16, grade 11 or so, grade 11
okay.
or 12, that's actually the age of my oldest child. So I have these conversations in my real life
okay.
all the time. And there's a lot of, I think, popular talk and popular discourse around what kind of degree is going to lead to the right kind of job, and that usually means what kind of degree is going to lead to financial stability.
Okay.
And I actually don't think that admissions counselors or parents or students have a crystal ball where they can look and see 6 years in the future and say, oh, if I get a degree in computer science, I will have a great job that I love that makes a lot of money. Because we don't know what the job market's going to look like in 6 years. And you actually, at 16, don't really know what
yeah.
kind of job you're going to love.
Exactly. The trend changes.
Because things change. And so the first thing I think about is flexibility and openness. And I don't want to use the phrase follow your passion, because that tends to ignore the fact that people do have bills to pay, right?
Yes.
And your passion might not be something that pays the bills. But I also think that saying, I'm going to spend 4 years studying this thing that only kind of sort of interests me because I hope it leads to financial stability, that's a recipe for burnout. That is a recipe for being really unhappy as an undergraduate student.
Okay.
So I think that focusing on what you want to study, the kinds of subjects that get you excited, that are going to actually make you want to do your assignments and turn them in and engage with your fellow students and professors, that's going to lead to a good university experience. And a good university experience is going to prepare you in terms of confidence, in terms of grades, in terms of recommendations from professors and other people, to go out and find a job that will lead to
okay.
a career. The other thing I say to both undergrads and graduate students is, what happens in the classroom is only a small part of your education. So whether it's volunteering or internships or part-time jobs, having something in addition to book learning is really important to sort of round you out as a student and as a professional. So I talk about sort of taking some of the weight and the intensity off of that decision. Oh my gosh, what do I need to study? Like, just a little bit lighter touch there, because I have a PhD in German and I'm a career coach, right? You don't really get there is no one-to-one correlation between this degree and this job now and forever, right?
Yes.
In our current in the current job climate.
Yeah.
You'll have more than one job. And so just doing something that gets you started somewhere is probably good enough.
Okay.
I'm the emotional support human for a very needy dog.
Okay. So let's say you have a student
mm-hmm.
who's going to graduate.
Mm-hmm.
And you mentioned that you have an 8-step tool that
mm-hmm.
you help assess what exactly are their priorities
mm-hmm.
and then proceed strategically. Can you tell me a little more about that and
mm-hmm.
give me an example perhaps?
Okay. The time budgeting tool that I use with people actually grew out of some insights I got in coaching. And I think that there are a lot of productivity people who probably talk about the same stuff, which is, how do you decide what you're going to do on any given day?
Yeah.
Like, do you personally, do you get up and open your email? Is that what you decide? Is that what helps you decide what your day is going to look like? Or do you, before you do anything else, already have an idea of like what your top three tasks for the day are? And so I talk with people about not letting other people's agendas,
mm-hmm.
the email that comes into your inbox, urgent requests for this, that, or the other thing, set your priority list. That
okay.
you start your prioritization with, what are my goals?
Okay.
Right? So if I'm a student, are my goals centered around, you know, tests and exams and papers, and I know the deadlines for those, and so I can sort of plan backwards, okay, if my goal is to do well on this assignment, how do I structure my days so that I'm prepared to do well? If you're a faculty member, your goals might involve publishing things or turning in grant applications, or this time of the year, a lot of my faculty clients are in the middle of writing letters of recommendation for graduate schools. So whatever your priorities are,
okay.
focus on those first instead of letting all of the little requests that come in all day long derail you. That is probably the biggest tip. But those priorities, when you're setting them, it isn't just what do I need to get done, but it's also how do I want to live? Who do I want to be? What do I want to be known for? What impact do I want to make? So if your priority is, I really want to be known for the stuff that I write, if making time to write is always the thing that falls off the bottom of your to-do list because it's not urgent,
yeah.
it'll never get done, right? If you want to be known as a speaker, if you're not actually going out and making that happen as one of your action items, you're not going to ever be known as a speaker either. So to really decide, like, how am I showing up in my own life? And then how do I want to show up in my own life? And then scheduling your days and claiming your time for the things that feed into that big goal.
Okay. My boss has an excellent analogy for it.
Mm.
Eat the frog in the morning.
Eat the frog. That is
attributed.
Yeah, that is attributed to Mark Twain, who said, if you eat a frog first thing in the morning, it is the worst thing you will have to do all day long, right? So just get that over with, and then the rest of the day is gravy. And and I was listening to an author talk about her work, and I tend to think that eat the frog is the way to go, but this author I was listening to talk, the way she does it is she always has multiple projects going. So if she doesn't want to eat this particular frog that's due tomorrow or whatever, she can avoid it by working on something else that is also due. So it's, for her, it's a matter of what do I hate the least today? Which is not quite as positive as eating the frog first thing in the morning, but is another way to go about structuring your time. Always know that there is more than one thing you could be working on, right?
Okay, look subjectively.
Exactly.
Okay. So when you have these students approaching you,
mm-hmm.
what are some of the health challenges that they face, like you see in
mm-hmm.
common? Like,
mm-hmm.
for example, exam time is nearing. So what do you see? Are they stressed out? Are they anxious? Or
I see a lot of anxiety. And especially when I was teaching undergraduates, you know, sort of day in, day out, I really got to see, especially in programs where I had a lot of students who were aiming towards med school or law school, and for them, you know, an A was the only acceptable grade, and they would just tie themselves into knots. And anxiety goes hand in hand with perfectionism, right?
Okay.
And so if you want or need that A, and you know that in order to get that, your work has to be exemplary. That's a huge ask of yourself. It has to be perfect. And when faced with it has to be perfect, a lot of people will have the completely human reaction of sort of freezing. Like, oh, I can't do perfect. Perfect is impossible. How do I do this? I'll avoid it and go over here and do this, and I'll avoid it and do that, and then all of a sudden it's due and you haven't made any progress because you're so afraid to start because you're worried about not hitting the mark.
Yeah.
Perfect. So what I have done sort of one-on-one with students when I was a professor sort of mirrors the advice that I give to people around anxiety and perfectionism as a coach, which is to keep with our animal analogies, it's eating the elephant one bite at a time, right? If the paper that's due at the end of the term that is 80% of your grade has to be perfect for you to get an A, that's an enormous task. Write a perfect paper and get an A. So you can break that task down into its smaller bits and pace those out such that if you know the paper's coming, okay, do I need 3 weeks to do a decent job on this? Okay, then 3 weeks out, where do I need to start? Where do I need to go next? And sort of map it out. Again, starting point A to point B, where you are now, where you need to go. What are the steps that you can take, the small steps, so that every day or every other day, you're doing a little bit of something that is forward movement towards the ultimate goal. And this is something that if you're in university, you can, if you give enough advanced warning, have a conversation with the professor around and say, listen, I know you haven't given the details for this assignment yet, but I like to work in such a way that I need 3 weeks. Could you share them with me so that I can get started? Or what, you know, can I have some of the parameters so that I can get started now, right? If you don't have that information in time. Professors will generally work with people who show the initiative of, I want to get this started so that I can be sane while I'm working and not, you know, pull all-nighters the week before it's due, for example. So breaking it down into smaller bits is good. And remembering that a perfect outcome is rarely the result of a totally stressed out process.
Mm.
And so if you can create a process that you feel good about, the chances of you producing a good product go up. So how do you want to feel when you're writing? What do you want your process to feel like?
Okay.
Writing or studying or whatever. And so focusing on how you want the process to feel so that the whole thing is a better experience than one that's just all cramped and tense.
Okay. So if I break down this process, you're talking about a person who understands this and acknowledges that they
mm-hmm.
have this issue,
mm-hmm.
and then they work towards the process of addressing
mm-hmm.
it.
Mm-hmm.
But these kids are young.
What if they don't understand?
Can they acknowledge? And job market constantly evolves,
mm-hmm.
the education system is different, and the way of teaching is also
mm-hmm.
evolving.
This
so
is true.
How can you help them be more aware and self-conscious and acknowledge it and address it a little earlier so that they don't get stressed out.
Okay. So this is something that is unlikely to happen with most professors in their classroom. They're not going to prioritize their students' mental health and coping skills. Campuses have resources for this frequently, but if I'm giving advice and if I'm coaching somebody who's in this position, we start with the assumption, and this is a very coaching assumption, I start with the assumption that you are perfectly capable and whole as a person, and that you have all of the creativity and all of the answers that you need, but you might not be able to find them all the time.
You're not perfect.
You're not perfect, and sometimes you don't have access to your own internal resources. So I coach people to pay attention to what's going on inside you.
Okay.
Right? Whether it's through mindfulness and meditation, whether it's through journaling, whether it's through a sort of symbols in a diary where you note good days and bad days and can you track patterns, but pay attention to what's going on inside you so that you can start noticing, oh, when this happens, I get really stressed out, or every time this assignment comes up, I lose my mind temporarily, or I'm so worried about this grade that I feel like I may be preventing myself from doing a good job because I'm so scared, right? And if you notice those things, that's sort of the first step, awareness. And then take a step back and see, is there another perspective I can take on this problem, right? So if students are struggling and they don't know the nature of the struggle, I could maybe have a one-on-one conversation with you and say, sounds like anxiety, or it sounds like you're not sleeping, or it sounds like you haven't had a solid meal in days or whatever, right, because you're stressed out. But in the absence of having somebody in your room talking to you, talk to yourself a little bit and see what you can notice about yourself. And once you've identified that, what can you do to shift your perspective a bit? I am looking at this through the lens of I have to get a well-paying job, or I'm looking at this through the lens of I have to get into medical school, or I have to get into graduate school. Those can all be true, but is there another perspective you can take that is more useful for you?
Okay.
Can you take the perspective of I actually really enjoy this topic and I want to explore it and share my findings with somebody? Or this semester is pretty rough. My goal is to get through by doing this, this, and this, just so I emerge at the end of the term intact. And sort of decide, what is your goal here? What does it mean to you, right? What does the experience of being in this class, doing that project, completing that work, what does it mean for you? And then gauge your response accordingly. But what it means to you should be what it means to you, and not a bunch of external pressure.